But now what we're going to do is we're going to turn our attention to our friend. We call him Cunneda, and he has been around, and he's been doing podcasts. And I happened to finally, I just last week got a Zune. I did not opt for an iPod because I've had iPods and it's very linear, you know what I mean? And I'm more of an intuitive kind of person. So the Zune sort of fits that more intuitive kind of way I am. So I got some podcasts. It's real easy to sync them up. And I was listening to Cunneda's podcast on Israel and his very, you know, just straightforward, you know, simple, and accurate teaching about Israel, what the Jews are. The Jews are really the stumbling block of the world, just as Jesus is a stumbling block for the world. You have the Jews and Israel as a stumbling block today. And people say, well, that's because it's not real. Well, all the fighting that's going on over it, all the fighting proves it's a stumbling block, proves it's beyond something of the natural world. And so let me, without further ado, bring my our friend Cunneda in. Cunneda, brother, are you there?
Yes, I am. Thank you, Zeph.
It's good to talk to you. I just talked to you yesterday when I was in my vehicle. That's where I get a chance to listen, and I was listening to your podcast. And it was amazing that, you know, how well you put it. You just kind of went through a straightforward beginning with Abraham all the way down to the present day and just taking it step by step by step on why people should not turn against Israel. Turn against Jews in general. They say, "Oh, I love the. I'm not against Jews. I'm just against, you know." But then they call the Jews the Illuminati. You know what I mean? There's this weird schism.
I don't know. I think it has something to do with the fact that the Jews see themselves, rightly so, as a special people, and I think that in the secular world that we live in, have lived in most of our lives, people resent that. We're all about inclusiveness, they say, and multiculturalism and all that, and they do not like distinctive groups, and the distinctive group that bears the signature of Almighty God is particularly disliked.
Okay, so God is, you know, once again, God is hated here. But how do okay, so we have this specialness again, just like we have the United States as an exceptional nation, and I know people take great issue with that.
Yes.
And, you know, hate the United States because of this American exceptionalism idea. And there's people within, like Obama and his friends, who are trying to destroy that notion forever and ever so that there will never be American exceptionalism ever again.
Yes, that's true.
In a way of, you know, leveling the playing field. Well, the same thing you could say with Israel. They want to take Israel, make it multicultural, and say the Jews are not of their... Well, okay, let me just hit you with some questions, because you're...
Okay.
All right, number one, they will say to you this. Yes, but in Israel, those are not the real Jews of the tribes of Abraham.
Nah, foolishness.
Okay.
You know, the Jewish people came onto the stage at approximately the same time or within a millennium anyway of the access of writing. So we have a historical record of these people.
Yeah.
We also have the witness of Messiah. The Lord would not have come were they not his people. He would not have come there. We have the testimony of the scriptures. And then after the dispersion, the Romans, like the Nazis, were very good record keepers. We have historical documentation of where those Jews went, where they are, who they are. This lunacy about the Khazars is just that. It's lunacy. Those were a steppe people of southern Russia. They were proselytized. The king decided to unify his people. He sent out ambassadors all over to choose a religion, and he chose rabbinical Judaism,
right,
because it seemed best for him to keep control of his kingdom. But his kingdom was entirely destroyed by the invaders from the east, the Mongols, and what was left of it was destroyed by the Rus, who we know now as the Russians. So that, you know, they have no lineage there. They were simply like the Ethiopians claimed to be. They were proselytes. You know, that was it. There's no root or branch or anything associated there.
Okay, so they'll say these are the people occupying Israel are mainly, you know, Russian Jews. So, you know, that was the great making Aliyah was the migration out of Russia because they were allowed to go, you know.
Yes.
And
but the Russian Jews came largely from Poland and right. immigrated in through that direction because of the pogroms through the Roman Catholic Church. Mm-hmm. At that point in history, as Russia was putting together an empire under Ivan the Terrible and some of his successors, they invited the Jews in because they needed the things the Jews could do, the technical skills, the money skills, the administrative skills, things like that. They just were not there in Russia at the time.
Okay.
So that's where the large group of Jews in Russia came from.
Okay, so, you know, so Israel is... And don't forget, and here's another thing that people don't really consider. There are Jews that are migrating to Israel all the time from all over the world.
Sure.
And they're,
certainly.
This, in fact, it's stepped up in recent times. And, you also said in the podcast that, and I recommend this podcast, it's called Cunneda's Rant. You do not rant, sir. You are...
No, it's Cunneda's Ramble.
Ramble.
I do ramble.
Okay. No, you do not ramble. It was very... There was a beginning, a middle, and an end, and it went step by step in a way that, I found it... playing the devil's advocate, I found it extremely difficult to poke any hole in your teaching, and that's really what it was. Cunneda's rant. Well, I don't know where I get rant from. I think I rant. No, Trish started that. Trish started rant. It's Cunneda's rant.
Maybe I'll change it. I don't know.
Okay. Now, what is the address of your podcast? Because he has a lot of other episodes. You got like 30 episodes or so, about 15 that are up there now.
Well, I only have 15 that are up. I only keep some up because I'm still on the free side over there yet. But it's Cunneda.podomatic. That's it. The Cunneda is just the only word they really need.
Okay, just put in Cunneda in the search. Go to podomatic.com, put Cunneda in the search engine, or Cunneda.podomatic.com.
Yeah, or you can, if you just go to Google and put Cunneda in, you'll get there also.
You'll get there. Okay, so
it's on there.
Cunneda, Cunneda.
Right.
And you will get there, and... see if you can poke a hole in, because see what I've noticed, and this is, it's so timely because, and again, I've been I'm the one ranting about this because I was seeing, you know, the same thing that we had in World War II happening again. And I no matter how much I've screamed about it, and I kind of woke up to the fact and I realized, you know, the Lord told me to be a friend of, you know, the Jewish people, a friend of Israel and all that. It was really pretty simple. In other words, the warning is, look, even if you can't be a friend, don't do the other thing of jumping in on the bandwagon and cursing the Jews. That's, you know, cursing Israel as, oh, it's Rothschild, you know, and all that. And saying there's a guy that people I see every day and they're putting out, they're just upset. The more they...
Oh yeah.
The more they start in with the hatred, okay? Mm-hmm. The more they can't get their way, so they ramps up every day to where finally they're just putting out, you know, Jewish items like the Star of David and other things with a big red line through it, and you know, it gets worse and worse. It's almost like a disease people catch, the anti-Jew mm-hmm. disease. It's bizarre. It's bizarre.
Yes.
And of course the Muslims are obsessed. Completely, Iran is upset. Not all the Iranians, but I mean, you know, the power elite in Iran are obsessed, and a lot of these leaders in the Middle East, they're obsessed with you know, it's a stumbling block. The Jewish thing is, they would have peace if it were not for Israel. America now, Obama's doing everything he can to turn against the Jews, to betray them while offering a hand of, what he's doing is he's kind of offering a hand of support and then betraying them at the same moment.
Well, that concerns me greatly because, you know, America, we started out in, I suppose you'd say we started out as a godly country or a Christian country, but we've gone a long way since I was a child in the 50s, the other direction. And in some ways I've thought that, our solid backing of Israel was maybe the last straw keeping God from putting judgment on this country. And if we throw Israel under the bus, which we are currently trying to do, and that's the whole idea. They want to isolate Israel so that they can move them to the edge, you know, and get rid of them. They want, that's what they want. The Jews are fine if they would melt into the population and not become a distinctive group.
Assimilate.
At that point, they'd get along just fine.
Assimilate.
That's what they want. And yes, that's if what they would assimilate. But they cannot. They cannot assimilate because God has forbidden it. Well, and he prevents it. Because it, when they assimilate and cease to be a people, that changes the plan of God. And nothing's going to be allowed to change the plan of God. It's just that simple.
Right.
When Jesus talked about his brethren, he talked about, you know, when you do this for the least of these, my brethren, the Christian church has made the mistake of assuming that meant Christians. Well, you know, there weren't
exactly.
any Christians when Jesus said that.
Exactly.
There was no ecclesia. Jesus' brethren were his family, the Jews. That is what he was talking about. He knew the troubles that his people would see in the next 2,000 years between the time he left and the time he would return. And he was telling us that part of how we will be judged or looked at will be determined on how we treated his brethren. Now, we are included in that because we are a part of Israel. We are grafted in.
Right. And yeah, it's how we treat each other as well.
That also extends mm-hmm. to his brethren of the blood, as well as his brethren through the blood. There are two differences
yeah.
there. We are all one, but of a different source.
Right. And, you know, if you look at Romans 11, it says, don't boast against the natural branches. And how the church
exactly.
became, and how the church started boasting that they are the natural branches, that's anyone's guess, but I guess it goes to pride, hubris, the kind of egotistical view of history that every group thinks the world revolves around them, right? So they become, you know, it's not surprising that we have people claiming to be, you know, that are not Jews at all, claiming to be the 144,000 virgins. who walk with, who follow the Lamb wherever he goes and sing a certain song. And these are translated really into glorified beings. They become the first fruits. And Jesus also said the last will be first, or the first will be last and the last will be first. To me,
yes.
that's also a picture of, you know, how the gospel went to the Gentiles because the Jews were blinded by Yahweh. This is my understanding. The Jews are
John the Baptist is the least in the kingdom of God, and he was the greatest of mortal men.
Right,
according
right,
to Jesus.
Right, and so the gospel goes to the Gentiles, which means that word Gentile is actually a Latin word, you know, or Roman Latin word or Roman word that means, you know, I'll just say Latin. That's more accurate. A Latin word that means actually genteel, like it's a feminine term. But it came to be associated with the nations, but in the Bible, when we're talking about Gentiles, they're talking about those out there who are non-Jews. You know what I mean?
It was the uncircumcised,
right? The goyim out there.
Uh-huh.
Okay,
yes.
Those people that are not, you know, part of the covenant, and so this gospel has to reach them, reach the whole world. Can't do so unless the Jews are blinded, unless the crucifixion takes place, unless the sacrifice of the Lamb takes place, so that the whole world and the whole material world is conquered. And then it returns, you know, the first will be last and the last will be first. And so it returns so that the first fruits would be the, you know, the exemplary Jews, if you will, would be the first fruits. In other words, it would go to the Gentiles, which are the nations, and then it would return before the Lord comes back, and there will be a remnant throughout Israel. And anyway, it's so clear to me. How does it become unclear? How do people get these various other theories? Because to me, it just seems clear on the face of it. Like the sky is blue, the sun, you know, rises in the east and sets in the west. It's that kind of thing, isn't it?
Well, you know, it's in a lot of ways, it's a lot simpler than what it seems, Zeph. The difference between you and I and some other people is that we believe God. I mean, it's that simple. We see it. He said it. Okay, that's it. It's that simple. It's a spiritual thing. God leads you to a certain point in your life. And when you get to that point, when you get to a place where you, I don't want to say see God, because that's not quite what I mean, but When you get all the way to the bottom of your life and you become a part of the Lord and you become a part of this mystical body, what you see is you see yourself as God sees you, and you never quite recover from that image at all. It either drives you to the Lord or it drives you insane or to commit suicide. And at that point, you believe, and you believe what God said. And people that don't believe what God said just have never gotten to that point.
And so
I don't know that their faith, whether it's a fraud, I'm not qualified to say that.
No.
But they are shallow in the faith, if they have a faith at all. And I suspect their faith is more in man than in God.
Well, then they take the scriptures and they start twisting all the scriptures in various ways.
That's what you do. You have to twist the scriptures to make it say something it doesn't. That's your only option. And that's what they do. And they've gotten very, very good at it. Very good at it.
Well, one guy that's really into it is the guy that calls himself a pastor, Pete Peters, he's got Scriptures for America, and I was reading those regarding what a Jew and Gentile is, and it's just reams and reams of apologetics on why Israel is not Israel and that he is Israel, you know, and there's like an Anglo-Israel going, you know, the Israel are the white people, he has it, you know.
Yeah, white, the British Israelism, that sort of thing, I've read some of their stuff.
Yeah,
it's interesting, I suppose. It flows from that era when Britain was the center of the world, and so they couldn't stand not being the center of revelation as well. So
I think that's probably where a lot of that came from. It's, you know, that what we call
hubris,
human-centric thinking, you know, or anthropocentric thinking, where each group thinks they're the center of the universe. And so they apply all the scriptures to themselves. And, you know, it's kind of like almost when we take the rapture theory, we have people that are going to be, you know, raptured. And then all someone has to say is, well, what about the Chinese or something, you know? And in other words, what if we widen the paradigm to the whole world and the persecuted church? Aren't they going to get a break too? Or if they rapture them now? Isn't that kind of a moot point after so many have been slaughtered? I mean, and now you're going to rapture a few here after all the slaughter and blood?
Yeah. Yeah, there's not much you can say to it. You know, it's interesting that all of those kind of theories, I guess would be the best thing to put. I don't want to put doctrine on because that gives the stamp of approval, and I certainly don't want to give that. But a lot of them came out of the same area there in England at about the same time in the 19th century. And they came with the group of people that had the hubris to start analyzing God's word to say who wrote this and who didn't write this by literary styles and all of this kind of stuff. And it all came out of the Age of Reason. And what the Age of Reason was all about was elevating man and getting rid of God.
Exactly.
And, our culture as a whole succumbed to that almost entirely, and we've spread that vileness across the globe.
Yeah, then it becomes, situational ethics, corruption, all that can then be justified with humanism. What could not be justified with, like, an absolute law of God, you know, right is right, wrong is wrong, black and white. But now with humanism, everything becomes a shade of gray. It's easy to then write your own laws. And if you don't like, if you can't live by those, you can just change them.
Yes, that's exactly it. If you remember, I spoke with you a couple weeks ago and I mentioned that I had been to a seminary, and that's exactly what the first course I was required to take was values clarification, where they could begin to take the values that I had and break them down by making me see that they were unkind and other kinds of words that they use like that to break down what you know is true in the spirit. Because as I told him, why do I need my values clarified? They work just fine as they are.
Yeah, they work just fine. You know, it's all about him, not us. And a humanist hates that idea.
Yes, entirely.
It's all about the thing is with me. Here's my problem: when I become my human self, when I get weighted in that, it's so hard to carry. It's so heavy in incompleteness and guilt and not quite there and almost, and the only way that I could then boost myself in human terms would be to get high on drugs, let's say, or, you know, something that causes adrenaline, like jumping out of an airplane or robbing somebody, you know,
or stepping on your neighbors,
or you know, abusing someone in some way and getting away with it and boosting myself in the corporate world by the extent that I'm sacrificing other people to the devil, and I'm right, you know, all of that kind of stuff. It's materialism. That's the realm of the material. I can't take it. I guess I'm just kind of a misfit. I can't handle it.
I'm a misfit too. I gave that up a long time ago when I gave God the unknown bundle, and I just said it's all yours from here on out. I've been fortunate. I've never been around a lot of money. I've never had the temptations that other people have. I was isolated with just me, my children, my parents close by, and we made a go of it, trusting on God alone. And every day I got up and trusted God, because every night I'd go to bed not knowing whether I'd make it the next day. Sometimes for sure I wasn't going to make it, but you know what? He came through every time. And I've just learned over the years that that's where my faith is centered. I don't get in the van and take my deliveries unless I'm sure he's in it with me. I go everywhere I go, he's there. It's become such a real thing to me that people would catch me talking sometimes, and I'm just having a conversation with me and God, and I'd forgotten there were other people around. I guess I'm kind of crazy like that. I don't know.
Yeah, you old coot. But you know, you're crazy like a fox, because you've got the peace that other people want.
And life has been so good since then. I can only tell you that.
Right, it comes through in your podcast. It comes through in your voice, you know, your voice. I'm very keen on the sound of people's voices, and your voice has got you definitely have that sound that is it's hard to explain, but it gives you great peace when you hear it, you know.
It's a good thing you never heard me sing.
Well, I'm sure it would, you know, it would be fine.
I'm loud anyway.
Yeah, but the thing is that so when you're going through this thing on Israel, you're going through step by step, and it's not like you're trying to bludgeon somebody or step on their toes or, you know, to do harm to anyone.
Oh, no.
You're just
I'm a teacher.
You're just laying out. It's not like you're debating anyone. You're just gently putting out the truth, and, you know, like the Holy Spirit's a gentleman too, you know. If you say no, he will gently go away. He's not going to batter your head with more and more stuff till you give in. He's just going to go away. And that's the way it is with this podcast. I mean, you don't make your point by screaming at the other person. You're just laying it out there. And if they don't want it, then, you know, you're just, you know, you're gone. And that's okay. It's not like a, you know, life and death thing on this one point. But so many people are now completely lost because of the snare. And I want to get into another snare that happens, not just the Israel question. But then we also get into the Bible itself, the veracity or reality of the Bible as a sacred document from God to us. And you know, it seems to me that the people that throw Israel out or get into replacement theology, the next thing they do is they start questioning the validity of the Bible we have. And you read from the King James.
Yes, almost. Well, sometimes I'll use another version if I just want to read a large straight through in a passage, because it's so much easier to read and for people to hear. But I always encourage people to go back and check with the King James, because I believe it is the only accurate version that we possess.
Okay, so we have this King James, and then I heard you reading from another version, but having versions is fine. Is it for real? Is this Bible real? It seems that the people that are throwing Israel under the bus are now questioning the Bible and the divinity of Christ, a couple of things. What are your thoughts about, obviously you believe it's real, but have you seen that pattern yourself where people...
Yes.
They have to start... Yeah, they...
Again, when they throw away the divinity of Christ... They have never experienced the Spirit of God, because without the divinity of Christ, you cannot have a sinless offering. Therefore, you cannot have a paschal lamb. Therefore, you have no salvation. You have no covenant. God has broken the covenant with Israel,
right,
and he has never made a covenant with Gentiles, if that's what you accept. Therefore, in their church, they're simply preaching, peace and harmony? Because they certainly don't have God.
Yeah, they put a labyrinth out there in the back so you can walk around in the labyrinth. But, yeah, with no divinity of Christ, hence no Christ, no Messiah. In other words,
that's right.
I said to them, if Messiah is not the divine, you know, Godhead, then I'm not a Christian. I have no salvation.
That's correct.
They do this
There has been no redemption. If Christ was not the spotless lamb, there is no redemption. There was no resurrection. And what we have is a group of people that just got together and fabricated a story. That's what they're saying, in essence.
It leaves it open. Well, for me, I wouldn't even be hanging around the Bible or Jesus. If that's the case, Jesus is not the divine Godhead. You know, Father, Son, Holy Spirit. If he is not, you know, that Godhead. The other thing I've noticed is they begin with saying the Trinity is an Illuminati concept, a false concept. And to me, the Trinity's fine. It's not like, you know, I mean, I believe in the one God, like, you know, Christ, God, Yahweh, Yeshua, you know, is one, you know. So it's not really a Trinity. It's just a way of looking at it. They do something like they say we're Unitarian, or we throw out the Trinity, and they call us Trinitarians, even though I'm not married to the concept. It's just that it just fits, you know, but I'm not married to it. But see, then they say Jesus is not divine. The Father is divine, but Jesus is the first fruit among the rest. We follow.
Well, the Bible in John 1 clearly testifies against that. The idea of a Trinity was formulated by the early Roman Church as an answer to pagan charges. Mm-hmm. And really, the idea of the Trinity is our human mind trying to understand God in the forms that we interact with him.
Yeah.
We understand God the Father. That's easy enough to understand. But then there's the Spirit that we also recognize as divine simply by those who live with the Spirit and experience it throughout their lives. They understand that it is divinity. And the Bible teaches clearly of Christ's divinity. And it's just simply beyond the comprehensions of our minds to put those all together. And I think that the doctrine of the Trinity stated is simply a mortal attempt to understand an eternal truth that is simply beyond us at this point.
Yeah. John 17 is that eternal truth put into words.
Yes.
Amazing that we actually have words to sum up something that is so, as they say, ineffable, that, you know, God is in us, we're in him, Jesus is in God, God is in Jesus as one. Mm-hmm.
And we have those words because God came and dwelt amongst us. That's why we have those words. Because it was God.
And we become one in him, and he is then one in us because of Christ.
Amen.
So we are together as one. And you know, so that doesn't make, you see, the Unitarian would say, well, that's what I'm talking about. And I say, no, it's not. You're talking about another concept. You're talking about, you're not talking about we are in God, God is in us as one. You're talking about Jesus being somehow separate from it. He's not exactly man, and he's not exactly God, so he's kind of in that nether world.
The Unitarian has a different Christ because he doesn't have a Redeemer, because he didn't have a sinless offering. Since he didn't accept that sinless offering, right, he cannot possibly have a Redeemer. Therefore, it is simply an intellectual faith. That's all it is. It's a faith of argument, and they make good arguments, and those who are not founded and dwelling in the Spirit can succumb to good arguments, because when you become of the faith, you don't become of the faith by an argument, because you become the faith by conviction of the soul and spirit. Mm-hmm. Those who become convinced by arguments can become unconvinced by better arguments. It's just that simple.
Oh, yeah, they go back and forth like, you know, with the wind. You know, here's a better argument. Oh, I'm over there.
Yeah.
Here's a better one.
That's
over there.
That's what Paul said.
I'm over there. Oh, here's another one over here. Boom, I'm over there. And they don't know who they are after a while. And they're chasing.
I'm sure you've seen that a lot more than I have with comings and goings through your ministry over the years.
Well, they do go. They do. Yes, that's right. They come and they go. They go just like they come in. That sometimes, usually when someone comes in super enthusiastically, like I heard you, I saw you on Twitter, and then I heard a pie, oh, my God, you know, blah, 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 and they're all And I'm like, okay, I give this guy about 5 seconds before he bails. You know what I mean?
You know, before I came in, I researched you, Zeph, because I heard you.
Yeah.
And I recognized you in the spirit instantly. And I went to your sites and I downloaded as many things as I could. And I listened to 40 or 50 of your broadcasts. And I was just thrilled. But after all these years, I had found somebody who understood the spirit of God and understood what life was about, and who also understood what it was like to be wounded and suffering. And then I joined. I guess I can't say more than that. And my whole getting back into ministry and teaching and my blog with the poetry is all a direct result of one podcast that you woke me up almost and shouted, "Time to turn your light back on." And God spoke to my heart, and everything since then has been a new life, a new walk almost.
You're like me with music. I had, you know, like when you were in seminary, I was playing in bands at that age, you know, and I left it because I thought I wasn't any good, you know, or I got intimidated, or I don't know what it was. I just, you know, and it was a wound. I didn't want to leave.
Yes.
I didn't want to leave, but then, you know, it's kind of comparable. But, so, I mean, I could take that a couple of ways. I mean, I finally found someone. It's like, oh, God, you know, and all I ever wanted was just to fit in.
And that's the one thing I've never been able to do. But
I couldn't either.
You know, we have so many oddballs here at Crazy Lamb. I kind of fit in here, and I truly appreciate that.
Well, they're not oddballs, you know, in our world and
they're not. I'm talking about the world's view.
Yeah,
of
we're
all strange.
But and a lot of these people, they view themselves as oddballs, you know, as I have. And that's not the way to look at it, folks. The way we have to look at it is that, look, if we're in the world, we're just like from another planet, you know. If you've ever seen a picture, there are stories about angels that fall to Earth or spacemen that fall to Earth or something, and then they're horribly mistreated, the story goes, and then they go back to their planet, you know, wounded. It's kind of like anything that's different, anything that doesn't conform. If you belong to God, if you belong to God at all, usually it's from an early age, and, you know, or it's from the way you were made when you came out of the womb. You were just like that, you know, from the foundation of the world. The world will not accept you from day one. And a lot of the people like this don't survive, but you know, God just is going to, he's doing this to kind of put it back in their face that not everybody is created to worship the world or material things or the material realm. It's not material things. It's really ultimately about power, personal power.
It's about recognizing and serving God. That's, some of us were created for that. I remember you talked about it once, that there's a light in your soul when you're born, if you're chosen of God, and the enemy can see that light, whether you see it or not.
Yes.
And others around you that are influenced by the enemy see that light. Even if it's a small flicker, it's there.
Right.
It's a part of what my next podcast, Eternity in the Heart, I'm going to talk a little bit about that.
That'll be good.
It's there.
It's there, and even if it's occluded by, you know, bad behavior and being upset, being uncomfortable, acting up, being self-destructive, which most of us can relate to, and all those things, the light is still there, and they still attack. They attack that light. They attack what's in you, hoping to convince you. And what I tell them is this: please listen out there. You can't make anyone different than the way they were made. You know, people are made like this, and you can't, I don't care how much you put them in slavery. I know one guy, they worked on him for, I don't know, 5 years, and it didn't take. You cannot be a Satanist if you weren't made that way, even if you do all the bad things they do. Like, okay, you shoot somebody, you have irrational, perverted sex or something. You hurt some other people emotionally. You do all the things they want you to do to join their club. And who'd want to do that once you know what it's all about? But there are plenty of people who are, they get to Hollywood or somewhere and they just want to jump in. But someone that's made a certain way, you can't make, they can do all those things, jump through all those hoops, pledge the allegiance to Satan daily, do what the witches tell them to do. You know, get all kinds of even, you know, dabble in the occult, do all this stuff, and still it won't take.
That's right. It's because God will pull out his own. And he there is some kind of a shield that he has that covers his own. I remember when I got pulled out. I was as bad as anybody. I stole my first car at 14. And okay. I was every bit of a punk. And I wound up in a jail cell. And God miraculously took me right then in a spectacular way. Mm-hmm. And even though it's been up and down on my part, God has never, never faltered, never wavered. Always been there. And it's that steadiness of God and that faithfulness of God and understanding that makes me understand back to what we were originally talking about, the faithfulness of God towards Israel, towards Abraham.
Yeah.
It's all a part of the same thing. If you know God, you understand the faithfulness of God is one of his attributes, and it simply does not change.
It doesn't change. And so what the Satanists have to understand, I'm sure in prison you found a lot of lambs in there, right?
Well, I wasn't actually in prison, but there were a lot of people that get Jesus in jail. That happens quite often. I went to the workhouse, so my thing wasn't quite as bad as that. It was more just punkish kind of stuff. But, you know, there are people. I have met people that have come out of prison. I met some when I was working out on the reservation in South Dakota. And there are people that God touches. And he puts them in prison because he has to isolate them from perhaps the surroundings they were in and degradate them clearly to where they can see no other way out. And sometimes that's what it takes.
Yeah, it's harsh. It's a harsh reality, but there is something about, you know, the incarceration. I know Richard Wurmbrand was incarcerated and tortured, and his faith was strengthened all the more as a result. But I don't believe that he could have endured those sufferings at all had he not had faith.
Oh, unquestionably, you're right. Faith is the strongest substance we know. I mean, and if you have God faith, if God has a hold of you, your faith is stronger than anything anyone can throw at you. It's simply unbreakable. They can break your body and they can kill you. They cannot destroy your faith. They can't even come close.
Yeah, it reminds me of a film I saw. I kind of fell asleep during. I have to watch it again. It was, I forget the name of it now, but basically this witch was trying to, had captured these Christians. And what she was doing is wanting them to renounce their faith. And she hooked a guy up, like, to draw and quarter him. It was during the time of the Black Death in the Middle Ages.
Mm-hmm.
And had one horse on one leg and one arm, and then another horse going the other direction on one leg and one arm. And she goes, renounce, renounce. And when other people saw that he was about to be quartered, you know, another guy did renounce. He said, I give up all faith, and I give up, you know, he publicly renounced Jesus.
Yeah.
And then she goes, you were the witch was running everything, right? Doesn't that make sense? And she goes, you are free to go. And then he left. And as soon as he was beyond the perimeter in the forest, they killed him.
Yes.
And I just guarantee, don't ever renounce your faith, because if they get you, and yes, that's run by the witches, because they have the vested interest in getting you to renounce your faith. So if you renounce your faith, what they'll do is this. They'll take you out in the back and shoot you rather than shooting you right there in front of the rest of the people. That's
kind of like the Nazi prison camps, you know, with all the Jewish police that actually did the rounding up and kept everybody under control for the Nazis. Many of them were taken out and killed before they could be discovered after they emptied the death camps.
Right, they're not going to let you live either way, so you might as well hold on to your faith. And then they finally let the horses go, and you know, you see the arms and legs fly off, and you know, just, you know, not literally, not so graphically, but you see that the guy was killed that way. And you know, ultimately, it was just what the movie showed is it just showed this, you know, tremendous war between these two forces, one represented by paganism and witches, which has now become humanism. And the other, which is just, you know, God's way and faith, you know, the way of faith, of the way, the truth, and life of Christ. And not that these Christians were not corrupt, they were, and they were violent back in that time too. But they were still of God in the sense that though they might have been making mistakes, and they were certainly being on trial, they did not belong to the pagans at all.
Understood.
They might have been violent at the time of the Crusades, but they weren't like they weren't pagans. That's all I can tell you. They were they were being hunted by the witches who ran paganism.
Yes. Yes, and the idea that, that they get others to announce their faith by watching one be executed is something that I think is probably going to happen again. And I don't know how near the future it is, but I suspect that public executions of Christians will be used, or believers. I don't really like the word Christian.
No.
Public execution of believers at that time will probably encourage many who are half and half on the fence to flee their faith, and I think that's probably the objective.
Well, I'll just tell you, if you get scared and publicly renounce your faith, they're going to shoot you in the head 5 minutes later. They're going to blow your head off, okay? Or they're going to cut your head off.
Nobody likes a turncoat.
No, not so. You're going to die one way or the other. So that's so that's what the movie was about. And I found that I found it interesting that someone would actually go to the extent of all the expense of making a movie about this very issue. And I think what they were interested in is just showing that there are two sides in this world.
That's the biggest convincing argument that believers have, is unbelievers simply do not believe there's a war going on. They simply refuse to see it or cannot see it, and that they are pawns within that war. They may even be combatants in that war, yet many of them simply don't see it. And it's a difficult sell.
Right. The what is front and center is Christ. He is the stumbling block of the whole world, and everything revolves around him. All the religions, the Muslims, the Jews, the Christians, the Buddhists, the communists, the Hindus, everything revolves around Christ, the whole world. And anything that is not Christ would be Antichrist, and then devolve to paganism, to the that would be layered over with, say, a religion. So you'd have a religion, and they say, well, isn't Christianity a pagan religion? And the thing is, but how many Christians, how many true Christians, let's say, are believers, if you will, how many real believers are there in the Christian church today?
There's few, I think. Most of us have been driven out. I think that the Christian church, if you look at the Christian church, is a form of paganism, clearly. Mm-hmm. And while I do think there are probably still some saved in the church, I think those people are in grave, grave spiritual danger. And as times draw to a close, I think they're in very great physical peril as well.
Yeah, because they will be sold out by the non-believers who run the whole thing.
Certainly.
You can't be a pastor today unless you're one of them. I mean, that's just an unfortunate reality. And I know these pastors will look at me and say, you're absolutely insane. I believe in God. I believe in Jesus. Here's the Nicene Creed, and I believe the Bible's the word of God. And how dare you speak to me like that?
Satan believes all of that.
You can't win an argument with these people.
You can't. I don't argue with them anymore. I just let it go, and I walk away. I get frustrated sometimes when I try and argue with them. So I just, say, well, you believe what you want. That there's consequences to beliefs, and I let it go.
Well, we had our friend John Norton, who joins us every week from the desert of Southern California, and he one time went on a campaign to evangelize pastors into the faith. He said
that was fun.
He said he said that went over like a lead balloon. That did not work. He said that ministry did not take off.
No, I was going to say that would be a tough sell, I bet.
The whole program was so that pastors too could actually, join the faith of Jesus Christ for once.
Pastors have had to blind their eyes to so many things that I'm not sure that very many of them can even open those eyes again. And the spirit has been so seared. When you reject God and you turn down God and you begin preaching a lie and doing all of these things, your spirit becomes so seared and so scarred that I'm not sure there's an entryway left for God to get back into you. I'm just not sure about that. I leave it in God's hands. He's much better qualified than I am on that, but I think it is difficult.
Could it be that the Lord is really, gathering his own from outside organized religion in a way? And
I believe that.
that he'll have a big remnant. I mean, he'll have a big, you know, he'll have quite a harvest, despite, you know, the world, you know, campaign against the true faith, because the true faith means separation, and separation means you're a target. They don't want anyone separate from anything. They want it, ever, like you say, all inclusive. So when someone separates themselves out, they are seen as the enemy, and let's go get them. You know, there's that attitude right there. They want to go get them.
I think that's why God tends to isolate his sheep. I think his lambs are isolated. I think they're protected. I know that I'm covered with the shield of God. He's put me here. There are things that happen all around here. Nothing happens to me. God takes care of his own.
Yeah, but you're not about to, you know, go put yourself in a situation where they're just teeming and seething, and there they are. You know, you'd go into one of their lairs and say, "Will you please like me? I'm just a guy that's a God-fearing guy that loves all people."
And, oh, no, I don't do that anymore, no. You know, like everybody, I had my time where I struggled with being isolated and being alone. But but I learned that being isolated with God is not being alone. It's being fulfilled. And my life, I have joys and comforts and graces in my life that men would give millions of dollars for that simply cannot be God.
I love it.
And
I love that statement you just made. There are people that would pay millions of dollars for the peace that you have on a daily basis, and you're not about to give that up anytime soon.
No, I'm not going to give it up at all. I can walk through, I can go into one of my kids' houses or at a party with all my kids, and I can have 10 noisy jumping grandchildren and noise and everything going everywhere, and I'm in the peace of God, and I just don't mind.
Wow. That's pretty amazing. Yeah. And I would imagine that would carry over to when you're just having to be in public, that you're trusting God to protect you through, you know, whatever he's asking you to do, wherever your route takes you, wherever your deliveries take you.
Oh, yeah. About 2 years ago, I actually got knocked off the freeway by somebody, and God just controlled the vehicle. He took it right down one ramp. An entrance ramp had been crowded a minute ago, suddenly emptied out. I went down a hill, back up the other side of the hill, landed right on that ramp. No damage to me or the van. I got out, looked around, got on my knees, thank God, and drove off. One time I was coming down a hill in snowy, inclement weather, and someone pulled in front of a truck, and he had to jam on his brakes, and I hit mine and started sliding. And I knew there was going to be a crash, and I was bracing myself, and all of a sudden I just stopped. Didn't spill the pop. Didn't pull me forward in the seat, but I just stopped. I had to pull off the road for that one.
Wow, yeah.
You know, I mean, God is good in ways that you just can't imagine, and you don't see it coming. I mean, it happens so fast. He's there. You know, it's what I said in one of my podcasts on worship, that, you know, everything with God is now.
Now.
He's always there now. Always it's now. So when you need it, you don't even have to take time to ask if it's that quick. He'll be there. But the key is, you have to trust and believe.
Yes.
And if that's absolute, so is he. It's just that simple. It works. It's like 2 + 2.
Well, it just gets so obscured with people. I mean,
they try and think too much, Jeff. Faith isn't about thinking. Faith is all about believing. God will do the thinking. You know, God gives me some of the greatest ideas for podcasts and all these things. It wasn't me that came up with that. I'd be blabbering my lips most of the time. I don't know how to speak to people. I'm terrible at public speaking. I stutter and I stammer and I misspeak. But when I go in the Spirit of God and I put that set of headphones on, I'm different. I'm different, and I can't explain it any more than that.
I understand. You know, I totally understand that you don't.
I mean, you can hear it when I'm done, because when I sign off and that, I mean, I'm exhausted.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just exhausted. And I know that that's because it was the power of God going through a weak body.
Right.
And it exhausts the body, but it thrills the soul.
Well, whatever.
I wish I had a better word than thrill.
Yeah, whenever I've been led to do a, you know, I'll look and I'll see that I've gone 2 hours, let's say, with no break. And to me, it was like 5 minutes. But then after it's over, and I don't even know how I got there, and then after it's over, I'm exhausted. I fall down, You know, it, I can't do it. I'm wrecked. But I also feel like, you know, okay, all right, you know, Lord, use me in any way you want. And, you know, if it's to talk on the air, fine. I don't know. What am I going to say? I have nothing to say. The microphone goes on, and the next thing you know, there's a whole...
You're going.
I can't get to it all. I'm barely able to cover all the material.
It's an amazing thing when God takes over and he just flows. He just just flows. You know, our language, we don't have the words we need sometimes to express it. I have that problem with my verse and my poetry sometimes, that I just get frustrated because I don't have the words to express the things I see and the things I feel.
Mm-hmm.
When you join with God, and sometimes you get these glimpses of things that are so wonderful, you want to tell everybody, but you don't know how. And sometimes I struggle with that as much as anything.
Yeah. It's we could go on and on speaking about all the things Lord has done and all the times we just didn't think it was going to happen, and then it did.
Oh, yeah.
All the time we thought, oh, you know, I'm really doomed here, and then it worked out. And then it's eventually, I guess, we just got to go, okay, I'm just going to put this thing on autopilot and go. You know what I mean? I'm just going to just put it on autopilot, meaning God the pilot, and I'm just going to go.
Yeah, sometimes you just got to stick your foot out and keep on going.
That's what you said about Abraham, bringing it back around. He just took one foot in front of the other, and he just kept going.
Yeah, that's what you got to do. You might not see where you're going. You might not know. But if God said go there, you go there. And, you know, it will work out. You know, he has the plan.
What do you think?
What's that?
Well, what do you think is going to happen with Israel now?
Now? I think that all of this is gearing up for another attempted attack on Israel. I think they're going to try and... I think Satan believes if he can destroy Israel, the Lord won't come back, because there's no Israel for him to come back. The same way when his first plan to keep the Lord from coming here the first time was corrupting the human genome, that Christ could not be a perfect human, he could not come. I think Satan's attempt now is to destroy Israel. I don't think Satan, Satan's not omniscient. He doesn't know everything that's going on. I think he was a little bit stunned and surprised with what happened with the state of Israel reforming. I think he thought he had the upper hand in destroying the Jews with Hitler, and it actually worked out exactly opposite of everything he had planned. And I don't think he's given up on that idea.
You would never have the state of Israel. You would never have Israel restored at all if Hitler was not on the scene.
No, without the Holocaust, there'd be no Israel. That's clear.
It's amazing. It's amazing. Anyway, there's just people I know out there who just won't yield, my friend. They won't yield. They just won't give up this Jew thing, the Jew hating, Israel hating. They just are going to go to the grave with it, and I don't know what's going to happen. We're all out of time. Cunneda.podomatic.com, and I thank you very much, brother, for being here. Stay right
there.
Thank
you, Zeph. I appreciate this very much.
Well, you speak very well, and we need your voice out there, because I know it was a personal comfort to me. Hang right there, my friend, and this time goes too fast, doesn't it?
It does. It's the quickest 2 hours every week when I'm on the chat line. It certainly is. I enjoy it. It's my fellowship.
It's just too much. Lord, what are you doing with the time? Okay. All right. Stay right there. This has been, mana. Okay. Well, here we go. More five.